So we are all here, and I'm thrilled to have everybody here this morning. We'll have some more people coming in, and so we'll have them go in the back door so we don't interrupt. But thank you. This is the TAG Health event for March. Just to let you guys know, we are also going to have the TAG Career Health Fair next Wednesday, so a week from today, down at Georgia State University. And it's from, I'm going to get the time right, 10 to 2. Everybody nods, so that must be the right time. 10 to 2, and we are co-sponsoring that with the Georgia Health Information Management Association, which is not HIMSS for Georgia, it's the other group, but most of them have the same membership. So we're going to be co-sponsoring that, 10 to 2, Georgia State University. And then the other event that I want to make sure you guys have on your calendar is April 20th. That's going to be a lunch event, and that's going to review the first 100 days of the Trump administration and the impact on healthcare and healthcare IT. Super excited about it, just about as excited as I am about blockchain. I can't wait for Jack to tell me what blockchain is. And so the first 100 days of the Trump administration, that's a panel discussion. So Justin Barnes, who I think many of you know, who was with Greenway for a long time, has his own company now. Wayne Oliver, who worked with Newt Gingrich and created the Centers for Healthcare Information Transformation, fantastic person, great on both the federal and state level. And then Joe Ganley from McKesson, who is their Vice President of Government Affairs, are all going to be on the panel. So thrilled, excited about it. So it's April 20th. Please mark it on your calendar now. And then hopefully if anyone can join us next Wednesday, we were thrilled to have you at Georgia State University. So I want to start by thanking our sponsors. These are our TAG Health Society sponsors, so our Gigabyte sponsors, Grady Health System, Grant Thornton, iVision, and Tier 4. So those are all of our Gigabyte sponsors. Our Megabyte sponsors are VMware AirWatch, Arketti, Cherry Beckert, and Comcast Business. So we appreciate all of our sponsors, and we're very thankful that they enable us to do what we're doing. The other item that I don't want you all to lose sight of is in November, I think you all know we do a big TAG Health, Healthcare IT Leadership Summit. That's going to be in November this year. Last year we did it in December because of the election, so it'll be in November this year. So first week of November, and Jody Branner will be leading that initiative, so you'll see more about that. But not to worry, we'll have events every month up until then, which may be a small break in the summer. So with no further ado, I'd like to introduce Jack Shaw, who I am thrilled has agreed to join us and share with us his information about blockchain. Jack is the co-founder and executive director of the American Blockchain Council. He has been a technology futurist for over 30 years. So we have someone on our TAG Health Board who wants that title, Jack, technology futurist. He helps other people understand the impact of emerging technologies, obviously in healthcare and healthcare IT. That's a pretty much job security. He's a world-renowned keynote speaker and was recently voted one of the world's top 25 professional speakers by over 27,000 meeting planners, executives, and conference attendees. He is the only technology speaker who was recognized in this category, so that's fantastic. In addition to blockchain, he's widely recognized for his expertise in artificial intelligence, Internet of Things, 3D printing, e-commerce, big data, predictive analytics, obviously huge in healthcare right now, cloud computing, mobile commerce, and supply chain management. He's a charismatic speaker and has delivered over 1,000 keynote speeches and executive presentations in over 20 countries, so great Delta Air Miles. Jack is a graduate from Yale with a degree in business administration and has his MBA from Kellogg in finance and marketing. So please help me in welcoming Jack to our session today.
As a practicing technology futurist for many years now, I am often reminded to bear in mind the immortal words of that great American philosopher, Yogi Berra, who put it so well when he said, "Making predictions is very hard, especially about the future." Nevertheless, I'm going to go out on a limb this morning and make some predictions about the future of healthcare, and in particular, the impact of blockchain technology on the future of healthcare. Now, how many people here have ever been to an orthodontist or taken kids to an orthodontist? Almost everybody. So I had the privilege just last month of being the opening keynote speaker for the annual winter conference of the American Association of Orthodontists. And in the course of preparing for that presentation, I had the opportunity to interview some of the leading experts in the field of orthodontics about the future of orthodontics and their ideas about the impact of emerging technologies on how orthodontics will be practiced in the years to come. I combined that with my own perspectives and insights to put together the scenario which you are about to see. So being so familiar with orthodontics, please join me for a short trip to the near future while we make a visit to the orthodontist in the 2020s. This is May. She's 12 years old and she's Japanese. She just moved here from Japan with her parents when her mother accepted a position as professor at a prestigious local university. As you can see, May needs orthodontic work. Knowing this, her parents decided to wait until after they arrived in the States to begin her orthodontic work so she could finish it during her mother's professorial stint. Now, while May is picking up English quickly, she still does not yet speak or understand it very well. And as we'll see, that won't really be a problem. The process starts when May and her father go to the closest local walk-in healthcare clinic. There, May sees a physician assistant who, among her other skills, has had several months of training as an orthodontic assistant. The PA first takes a photo of May and then uses a scanner approximately the size of a large electric toothbrush to thoroughly scan May's oral cavity in about 1 minute. The PA then shows May and her father a selection of augmented reality images of May's own face with a range of different smiles based on those typical for Asian women of Japanese and other cultures. With her father's help, May selects the look that she likes best. May's photo, her intraoral scan, and her desired appearance are then uploaded to her blockchain-based self-sovereign electronic health record. Through an app on May's flexible smartphone, she and her father authorize the sharing of this information along with her insurance and contact information only to certified orthodontists who have offices within a 15-minute drive of their home. Of the several orthodontists who respond to this new information, one is Dr. Barbara Gutierrez, whose practice is located about 8 minutes from May's home. She has an app running on her practice management system, which among other things continually scans for prospective new patients. The app notifies her that a 12-year-old named May, who lives nearby, is looking for orthodontic services. Her practice management app analyzes the information for May's health record for her case. Her intraoral scan, her desired outcome, and her insurance coverage. It then develops three alternative preliminary treatment plans. These are each based on producing the desired outcome quickly and effectively for the patient and profitably for the orthodontist. Dr. Gutierrez reviews the three plans. She eliminates one which she feels is unlikely to produce the desired results as reliably as the other two. She then asks her practice management system's intelligent assistant to schedule a conference call with May and her father for 10 minutes at a time which is available on all three of their calendars. It turns out there's a time slot open early that afternoon. On receipt of the call from Dr. Gutierrez, May and her father's smartphones instantly detect that Dr. Gutierrez is speaking English and translate her speech fluently into Japanese. Dr. Gutierrez's phone does the same thing so that each participant can both speak and clearly hear in the language of their choice. Later in the office, the same thing will be accomplished via nearly invisible earbuds, which each person will be wearing and which are wirelessly connected to their smartphone's translation apps. After introducing herself, Dr. Gutierrez explains the two options she recommends and the advantages, timing, and costs of each. After some discussion, May and her father decide they like Dr. Gutierrez and agree to schedule an initial appointment. their intelligent assistants consult their respective calendars and identify a mutually convenient appointment time for early morning the day after tomorrow. When May arrives at Dr. Gutierrez's office, she and her father check in with the robotic receptionist, who, of course, speaks Japanese fluently, along with approximately 600 other languages. May is a bit taken aback when the receptionist tells her that the initial examination is going to be done by a human assistant. Her father explains to the receptionist that in Japan, virtually all medical, dental, and orthodontic assistants are robots. The receptionist reassures May that Mr. Williams, who will perform the initial examination, is both very experienced and very personable, and that, in fact, he has a granddaughter the same age as May. She also explains to May's father that Dr. Gutierrez has already selected an excellent robotic assistant, which he will be using once Mr. Williams retires next year after having completed training of his replacement, of course. After Mr. Williams completes the preliminary exam, he tells Dr. Gutierrez that the reports and analysis of the treatment planning system appear to be valid. So Dr. Gutierrez conducts her own examination and comes to the same conclusion as Mr. Williams. She shows May on the image display screen and her father a few key points and explains how and why the two alternative treatment plans differ. She concludes by recommending Plan B. Now, treatment Plan B will take a little longer than Plan A, 4 months versus 3 months. But the out-of-pocket cost will be considerably less for May's family, and the long-term results should be superior. For her own part, Dr. Gutierrez's margin will be slightly less, but still well within her practice guidelines. May and her father agree that Plan B is the way to go. So the three of them authorize the treatment plan and related payment schedule through their smartphones. This information is all recorded on a blockchain-based smart contract linked to her electronic healthcare record. Once the smart contract has been executed, it immediately authorizes Dr. Gutierrez to download the design for a customized set of dynamic smart braces to the 3D printers in her office. These braces are descendants of smart brackets originally developed at the University of Freiburg in Germany in the early 2010s. May's appliance will include brackets which continually monitor 6 vectors of force and motion for each tooth, adjusting those vectors dynamically in accordance with the treatment plan, and uploading the data continuously to her electronic health record via their built-in Internet of Things circuitry. Once the appliance designs have been downloaded, they are printed out in 4 parts on 2 of Dr. Gutierrez's 3D printers, 1 printer for the ceramic parts and 1 for the metallic. Dr. Gutierrez then assembles each set of braces and places them on May's teeth. The entire process of downloading the designs and printing, assembly, and placement of the appliance is completed in just under an hour. May and her father approve the appliance through their smartphones and leave the office excited about May's new braces. On receipt of approval of the placement of the braces, the smart contract automatically transfers funds for the agreed initial payment from both May's family's insurance company and from the designated account for their co-payment, which in this case is by utilizing the value of the frequent flyer miles on their airline traveler program into Dr. Gutierrez's account. The account is credited in full for the initial payment by the time May and her father reach the sidewalk. Over the next 30 days, Dr. Gutierrez's intelligent assistant monitors May's treatment daily. On 2 occasions, when it seems warranted, it notifies Dr. Gutierrez to take a look at the results herself. In each case, after a couple of minutes review, Dr. Gutierrez concludes that May's treatment is progressing within appropriate parameters. Every 30 days, May consults with Dr. Gutierrez remotely to review her progress and provide personal feedback to the doctor. On the second such occasion, Dr. Gutierrez tells May that she recommends adjusting the treatment plan slightly to produce better long-term results. She explains that as a result, May will feel a little additional pressure on her upper molars for the next few days. May agrees, and the doctor transmits the appropriate adjustment to May's braces, which begin applying the change that night while May is sleeping. At the completion of each remote consultation, any changes to the treatment plan are recorded in May's electronic health record, and progress payments are automatically transferred to Dr. Gutierrez via the smart contract. After 4 months, May returns to Dr. Gutierrez's office for the final examination. They both agree that the treatment has produced the desired outcome. Dr. Gutierrez removes the braces for the materials to be recycled. The smart contract automatically transfers funds for the final payment to Dr. Gutierrez's account, and May walks out of her office with a smile a mile wide. What enables this degree of innovation? Is this pretty much what your experience was when you went to the orthodontist? So what makes it possible? Clearly, it's not simply application of any specific technology, even one as powerful as blockchain technology, on the outside of existing systems and processes. At the same time, blockchain technology plays a critical role in this scenario of enabling a transition, not to simply a series of isolated new point solutions, but a complete digital transformation of the systems and processes involved. Blockchain shows tremendous progress. No less reputable a publication than The Economist magazine said that blockchain is quite simply the most important advance in record keeping in the past half millennium since the invention in 1494 in Florence, Italy, of double entry bookkeeping. Not surprisingly, publications all over the world and in many, many different fields have touted the benefits of blockchain technology. I was asked to give a quote for one of those publications recently on the meaning of blockchain, and I just thought I would go ahead and post it up on LinkedIn Pulse just to see if it got any response, and I was delighted that it got over 1,000 responses and hundreds of likes and comments. And it's quite simply that wherever people, processes, businesses, governments, or the social good requires proof of identity, ownership, transactions, or commitments, blockchain technologies promise to meet those needs with a degree of trust and integrity never before possible. And in the example we just looked at, all of these things come into play. So what is it that blockchains do? People tend to get way too hung up on the technology of how blockchain works. We'll touch a little bit on that. What's more important is, what can you do with blockchain? Blockchain allows two or more entities, people, organizations, businesses, what have you, to share information on the internet without having to utilize a third-party intermediary. It provides an immutable, time-stamped record of identity, ownership, transactions, or commitments. It provides complete transparency only for those authorized to see. And even they may not append new or update records to the blockchain unless they're also authorized to do so, while at the same time providing unhackable security against those not authorized to see or update that information. It's these combinations of capabilities that blockchain can provide that give it its power to transform processes and systems across our global economy, and certainly healthcare is one of the areas where it's most important. It's not where it emerged first. The very first application of blockchain was in the digital currency of Bitcoin. And it's the most mature application of blockchain technology. For that reason, because it's so widely used, as an example of blockchain technology, people all too often conflate the two and assume that Bitcoin is blockchain and blockchain is Bitcoin. It's important to make the distinction. Blockchain is the underlying core technology that enables Bitcoin as simply one implementation of thousands of potential use cases, hundreds of use cases already in the course of being implemented and that have been implemented in many, many cases. But it is a good way to show the underlying principle of how it works. Let's take a look at how a simple digital currency payment such as Bitcoin would take place utilizing the blockchain. If person or entity A wants to send money to B, that transaction is represented online as a block. Typically, in fact, blocks contain a number of transactions that are all taking place during a given period of time. But a given block then is broadcast to every party in the network, each one of whom independently runs a special cryptographic algorithm confirming that that transaction and that block is valid. And then the block can be added to the chain. So we now have an indelible record in all of the locations on the blockchain of this transaction. We now know that person A no longer has that specific piece of digital currency. It now belongs to person B to do with as they wish, spend it, pay it to someone else, hold on to it as they see fit. Now, one of the things used is a process called hashing. Anybody here ever juice an apple or fruit or vegetables or see them juiced, okay? How many of you have done that, okay? Most of you have seen fruits and vegetables juiced. How many among you have taken a container of fruit juice and turned it back into an apple? No one? It's a one-way process. You can't go the other way. You can't unscramble the proverbial egg, okay? And this is what is the key to what are called hashing algorithms. A hash function is a one-way mathematical function. And the way that that mathematical function is it takes a certain piece of data. It could be a single character, a single word. It could be a sentence like we see here. It could be the complete contents of War and Peace. It could even be the design for 3D printing of a set of braces. And it processes it into a fixed length output that is absolutely unique. So each one of the outputs of this hash function is different and is unique, and you cannot work backwards from the output to figure out what the input is. But what you can do, if there's any question about whether one set of information matches another set of information, is you can run them both through the same hashing algorithm. If they produce the same output, then you'll know that they're identical. But if somebody took War and Peace and changed a single comma in it, you would get a radically different output as a result of that. And you would know that the original document had been tampered with in some way. That's part of how we can verify identity and ensure consistency of assets, because we use what are called hashing functions in blockchain technology. And one of the ways that that is done is that each block contains in its header a hash of the contents of the previous block. That's what chains the blocks together, hence the block chain. So if you wanted to go in and change one of those early blocks so that instead of saying Kate owes Jack $100, it says Kate owes Jack $100,000, well, first of all, you'd have to go to the time and effort of hacking through all of the security that that particular blockchain node has in place, all the cryptographic protections and so forth. But if you had enough skill, resources, and so forth to be able to do that, you could go in and change that transaction. But the problem is, if you did that, that block would no longer match the rest of the blocks. So you'd not only have to change that transaction, you'd have to rewrite all the rest of the hundreds or thousands or hundreds of thousands of in that copy of the blockchain. But even if you did that, that still isn't going to solve your problem. because blockchains are distributed on multiple nodes all over the internet. In the case of the Bitcoin blockchain, we have tens of thousands of nodes. Now, this shows you what the rough location of those are, and it won't surprise you to see that they're in the areas of greatest economic activity globally. The total computing power in the Bitcoin blockchain is estimated to be now in excess of 100 times Google's total computing power, and in fact, growing much more rapidly. So if you were able to hack into one of those nodes and rewrite that copy of the blockchain, as challenging as that would be to do, it would no longer match all of the thousands of other copies of the blockchain. And they would all reject it and say, wait, you're not matching up the way all the rest of us match up. We're going to ignore that, and the systems and processes that utilize that information would only pay attention to those that were consistent. You would have to hack into more than half of those copies of the blockchain in order to be able to get to a point where you have a majority of the nodes saying that your falsely rewritten version of the blockchain is the valid one and not the one that was in fact originally correct. Now keep in mind that you have to hack into each and every one of those separate nodes, each with their own separate different types of external security, each with cryptographic protection, and then rewrite all of those copies of the blockchain completely. Oh, and by the way, there's one more catch. The blockchain synchronizes every 10 minutes, which means you've got to hack into all of those sites worldwide and get the whole job done in less than 9 minutes and 59 seconds. One physicist has estimated that the amount of energy that it would take to drive the amount of computing power that would be needed to simultaneously hack into all of these thousands of nodes all over the world, break through all of their cryptographic protection, rewrite all of their copies of the blockchain, and get that all done in less than 10 minutes is roughly equal to the amount of energy emitted during the same period of time by the sun. So, is it theoretically impossible to hack the blockchain? No. But it's never been done, and for very good reason. The bar has been raised orders of magnitude higher than anything we have ever previously had in terms of the security of information. Now, that doesn't mean we can be cavalier about security. Oh, we've got a blockchain implementation in place. We can start handing out our passwords to everybody. No, because we're still going to have to access the blockchain with other systems. There's still going to be social engineering ways to get around security. But we have a much, much more powerful tool available to us than we have ever had previously. And what this means is that you can store not just assets of digital currency on the blockchain, but what about other assets, like your car title, the deed to your home, your authorization to cast a ballot in an upcoming election. There's a host of other things that you could be storing on the blockchain, and that includes electronic medical records. The blockchain can be the answer of, well, if we have electronic healthcare records, who owns them? Is it the healthcare provider? Is it the insurance company? Is it a big technology company like Google or Amazon? The answer that seems to be emerging is none of the above. Each of us as patients and consumers will own our own self-sovereign electronic healthcare record, but stored on the internet where anyone we authorize to access can do that. Now, you could put one more kind of asset, if you want to think of it, on the blockchain, and that's what's called a smart contract. A smart contract is a computer program that can run on a shared ledger or blockchain, as it's referred to, which can take over custody of assets on that ledger, if so authorized, according to those who have agreed to participate in the contract, two or more parties, and can track what has happened and respond to incoming information or events, such as the patient has approved that the procedure has been completed satisfactorily, therefore initiating transfer of funds for the final payment from the appropriate insurance and patient co-payments accounts to the healthcare provider's account. So what this does is it provides for patient-mediated health data exchange, where secure data access to authorized health data is based on the patient's consent. That provides you with accountability. transparency, privacy, security, control, provenance of the data, all consent, access and updates can be traced back to exactly who, what person, system, provider, insurance company, what have you, actually made those updates. We know exactly when, where, and how all the data was updated. Everyone authorized to see it in a common place will be able to do so. Now, one of the things, unfortunately, that this means is that you'll not have the privilege of every time you go to any doctor or healthcare office getting to fill out the same 17 forms that you filled out just last week when you were in the same doctor's office. As much as we'll miss that, I think you can see some of the benefits. But those are just some of the potential applications in healthcare. And what I would like to do is share with you some of the others. In interest of time, we don't have time to get deeply into the implications of each of these. I just want you to understand how broadly blockchain may be able to impact healthcare systems in the years to come. We've already talked about blockchain-powered health information exchange, doctor vendor RFP services, similar to what I described when various orthodontists were submitting proposals to provide for maze treatments, Internet of Things and the blockchain, for our wearables to update. So, for example, if you're wearing a Fitbit, or if you've got a pacemaker installed, or if you've got braces installed, that they can continuously report to the blockchain your information so that the healthcare providers who need to see it have it available to them and they can act on it in whatever way they need, and yet so that no one who is not authorized to see it can see it. Even notarization or identity verification, registrations, physician credentials, so that, for example, only credentialed orthodontists within a specified distance are allowed to see this information in order to submit a proposal for treatment. But it's not just on the healthcare provision side, but on the procurement of parts, materials, supplies, pharmaceuticals that are needed in healthcare, collaborative crowdsourcing, medical banking, supply chain provenance of parts and materials, so that those people, for example, who are manufacturing medical devices know that they're not suddenly going to get picketed by Greenpeace because their supplier produced some of the rare earths used in the electronics of the medical device that they've made by procuring it from an area maintained by warlords and using slave labor to be able to create that. In fact, we already have a supply chain in the diamond industry that does exactly that, ensures that people do not have blood diamonds because they're able to track diamonds immutably from the time they're removed from the ground through every exchange that takes place until they're sold to the end purchaser. And counterfeit drug prevention and detection to help protect and enhance the pharmaceutical supply chain. On the payment side, health document notary services, validation of payments and claims, as we saw, payments taking place much more quickly at much lower cost and much less friction in the system than what we had before. Real-time contextual forms of insurance and even outcome-based payments, where information from Internet of Things health wearables, for example, or implanted devices, or external devices, continually reports on the patient's status, and payments are made to the healthcare providers based on satisfactory income outcomes as reported. And on the research side of it, in clinical trials, improving the accountability, the transparency of data to those who are doing the research, and the accountability that it is the accurate original data, population health management, genomics research, and even connectome files. For those of you not familiar with it, the connectome is the diagram, if you will, of the wiring of our individual brains and is part of the future of healthcare. Looking at all of these, what it means is that people who choose to anonymously share their health data for research purposes can be absolutely assured that nobody will ever be able to reverse engineer to figure out what portion of that data came from any specific personal patient or individual, at the same time that the medical research community has access to much better, more complete, timely, and accurate data regarding all kinds of different conditions that this research can benefit. Already, in the Department of Health and Human Resources, Office of the National Coordinator for Health Information Technology, last summer, they solicited a whole series of papers on how blockchain technology could be used for healthcare and or health-related research. And they got 77 different papers. And by the way, you can access on their website, and we'll have on a copy of this presentation a link that will take you to that. And you can download and read all of those white papers if you would like to. 15 winners were announced, and those 15 winners presented them in late September at the National Institute of Standards and Technologies headquarters, with presentations coming from everybody from the Office of Science and Technology of the White House to the National Institute of Science and Technology, Department of Homeland Security, major organizations, technology providers like MIT, IBM, Accenture, and many, many smaller ones. And then just last week, on March 14th, they held a blockchain and healthcare hackathon and invited a number of interested parties to participate in using blockchain technologies to address one of three healthcare trends: identity management, metadata tagging, and data aggregation and linkage. And two of them tied for second place: an organization called TMI, which was tracking identity management and provider identity claim attestations, so a healthcare directory solution that would lead to exactly the kind of thing that I described in terms of identifying certified orthodontists within a specified distance. Nucleus Health, using medical images, demonstrating how blockchain technology could be used to share medical records, such as the intraoral scans and photographs of the orthodontic patient in that particular case. And the Health Passport, which provides for the decentralized health record, allowing patients to take control of their health information and determine that, yes, this information can be shared with this healthcare provider, this information can be made available to that particular insurance carrier, and so forth. All of this falls under the category of digital transformation. Digital transformation about our health systems is not something that can be dependent on force-fitting new technologies, whether it's blockchain or anything else, into your business. It's about rethinking the entire model and the entire ecosystem, and then using any and all of these powerful emerging technologies: blockchain, artificial intelligence, Internet of Things, 3D printing, augmented reality, data analytics, robotic assistance, and so forth and so on, to implement that vision over time. Now, it's outside of our scope today to get into a detailed discussion of the digital transformation process, but I can tell you at a high level what we've found in working with our clients over the years that is still very applicable for blockchain and other emerging technologies is an approach that's referred to as third horizon planning. And to summarize it at a very high level, what third horizon planning is, it's planned and executed in three parts. One, the third horizon plan, is the long-term vision of the digital enterprise or the digital environment that we anticipate finding ourselves in 3 to 5 to 7 to 10 years out. Where do we want to get to? Far enough out that we have a time cushion to overcome short-term constraints of process design, infrastructure, or application functionality of our systems. First horizon planning says, where are we today? Where do we need to go later this year? It's the typical kind of annual planning that most organizations should be going through. But with a third horizon plan in place, it tells us, you know what? Some of the things we are doing today won't need to be done in the future. We will be able to discard them entirely. Other things will be so dramatically transformed that there's no point in trying to evolve the existing versions of those processes to the new ones. But in most cases, most of those things will be able to evolve toward a radically improved digital version of how they function today when we get to that point in the future for which we're developing our third horizon vision. And those are where we want to focus most of our time and effort on evolving those processes. Probably don't want to spend a whole lot of time and effort invested into those parts of today's processes that are going to go away in the long term. And we might have to stop a little bleeding, fix a few problems here and there to make sure we keep them working. Because we want to keep the car rolling down the street while we're changing the tires. Second horizon planning fills in the missing pieces. What about those things we are going to be doing in the future, would like to, will be enabled to be doing by these emerging technologies that we are not yet doing as part of our existing operations today? That's where you set up the skunk works, if you will, the isolated processes, isolated from short-term pressures of operational issues and financial issues and so forth. So you can experiment with the new technologies like blockchain or AI. You can experiment with revised processes in a limited proof of concept kind of environment, with the objective being that over time, as those parts of the first horizon, current activities, evolve toward that vision, and the additional parts that will either replace or add to those capabilities that you're testing in your skunk works evolve eventually over that 3 to 5 to 7 year or longer horizon. They will merge together into the third horizon vision that you put in place. Now, of course, in reality, it's more complex and sophisticated than that, because you're not going to lock your third horizon vision in place right now today for where you're going to be 5 years from now. So in effect, it becomes a moving target too. But there are ways to address that, and happy to discuss that in more detail. If you'd like to learn more about the digital transformation process or about blockchain, one of the things that the American Blockchain Council does, its purpose as a not-for-profit organization, is to help senior executives, senior-level decision makers, understand the strategic business implications of blockchain technology, not only in healthcare, but across business and society. We've developed a series of blockchain executive seminars, ranging in length from an hour to a full day, targeted at those senior decision makers, but also such key other players as accountants, auditors, attorneys, even senior IT management. I say even because the focus is not on the technical details of implementation. There are plenty of sources for that information that are out there. But 30 years plus as a technology futurist has made it very clear to me that it is not the perception of technical elegance on the part of the hardcore geeks that drives adoption of new technologies. It's the willingness and understanding and ability to invest on the part of senior level decision makers that drives the adoption of new technologies. And that's why the American Blockchain Council is focused on helping those senior decision makers understand such things as, what is it? How does it work? As far as they need to understand how and why it's different and in what ways it's better than previous technologies. What is a smart contract? What are the legal and accounting issues? We're here in the offices of a law firm, and believe me, they are focused very strongly on what the implications of those are. There are people out there claiming that blockchain is going to make attorneys and accountants go away. Absolutely not true, any more than the claims 20 years ago that the internet was going to make governments go away. But what it is going to do is it's going to dramatically change the roles of attorneys and accountants and auditors. How do we assure identity and security? How is it going to impact our business? What opportunities do we have as a result of blockchain technologies? How do we plan for them? These are the kinds of things that we go through. And for those of you that are with organizations that provide blockchain-enabling solutions in one way or another, perhaps technology solution providers, or again, as I said, accountants, attorneys, what have you, these kinds of programs can also be adapted for presentations to your clients or prospective clients. So if you'd like to find out more about the blockchain executive seminars or executive briefings, please see me afterwards or contact me. My contact information for the American Blockchain Council is here. I also would like to encourage you to join the Blockchain Executive LinkedIn group. Look it up. You'll find it's focused on strategic business applications and use cases for blockchain, with now closing in on 2,000 senior-level executives from all over the world participating in a fascinating exchange of ideas about this exciting new technology. and the impact that it's going to have in all facets of society, and particularly in healthcare. Thanks very much for listening. Got Michelle about 7 or 8 minutes for questions, is that right?
Great, Jack, if you don't mind entertaining questions.
I would be happy to do so. David?
Who invented blockchain and who owns it?
A great question.
Nobody knows.
Nobody owns it any more than anybody else owns the World Wide Web. It was the invention of blockchain emerged from a number of parallel technical developments that took place over the last 30 years. But it was all put together in a paper written in fall of 2008, so coming up on 9 years ago, by some person or group of people pseudonymously known as Satoshi Nakamoto. Nobody has ever determined exactly who or what Satoshi Nakamoto is. I've heard speculation by various experts in the field as to who Satoshi Nakamoto might be. Some people think it's not a single person, it's a group of people. But this white paper was published in 2008, and at the beginning of January of 2009, the very first Bitcoin block, Genesis block as it was called, was created. Bitcoin's been growing since that time. At the very beginning, nobody expected a digital currency to be worth much of anything, so lots of people could make lots of Bitcoins. In fact, a couple of months later, the first actual purchase of Bitcoin was made when a fellow paid a very willing and open-minded purveyor of pizza 10,000 Bitcoins for two large pizzas.
Wow, that's a fortune.
Bitcoin is now worth $1,200 per Bitcoin, so that would be a $12 million pizza. Well, $6 million a piece if they'd held on to the Bitcoin instead of buying the pizza with it. But, you know, that's what happened. So that's a little bit of the background and timing on it. From a broader perspective, Bitcoin was not even very widely recognized at all. Probably started to get attention maybe around 2011, 2012. And just as one of the first breakout applications of Internet World Wide Web technology back in the mid-90s was pornography, one of the first applications of Bitcoin was in illicit areas of the economy, criminal activities like drug lords and terrorists and hackers taking hostage systems and stuff like that. Well, those things are still around, but they've been rapidly supplanted and expanded by other technologies. And starting about 4 or 5 years ago, just coincidentally around the time that I happened to start investigating it myself too, people increasingly began to realize that the real gold was not in the Bitcoin currency itself, even though that eventually, I believe, digital currencies will become a valid alternative payment mechanism in the same way that back in the late 60s, the 70s, and the early 80s, credit cards and later debit cards became an additional payment mechanism as opposed to simply cash and checks, which was all that we had had previously. But the blockchain is the much, much bigger deal, in my opinion, in terms of its impact.
So if I want to incorporate blockchain in my technology or whatever use case, I don't have to pay anybody for that?
You don't have to pay anybody for the rights to use blockchain. Paul, would you? We talked about this just the other day. This is Paul Arney from Morris Manning & Barton.
Let me see if I can answer that question at least quickly. The original Bitcoin actually has some technologies that there's some additional stuff that's really useful in connection with blockchain that didn't exist at the time. But what happened was the original Bitcoin concept was a combination of a few technologies that already exist. It already existed. Hash functions, they've been around for a very long time. Public key infrastructure, the RSA algorithms have gone out of patent, so those are not anything that people can have, distributed database technologies and timestamping. And so the combination of those things put together is what created Bitcoin and also sort of generally defines the basics of blockchain, although again, blockchain has gone further than that. So if nobody filed for a patent with a combination of things, all of the things that got built into it had already existed for a very long time. So there's no patent rights. Copyright doesn't protect that type of thing. It was published. There's no trade secrets. Trademarks don't matter. We're running out of intellectual property rights. So there, it really isn't. When Jack says that nobody owns it, it's actually true. Really, it's an idea, concept, series of technologies. But at least with respect to the basic aspects of blockchain, nobody owns it.
And let me just add to that, and then Kate's got a question. And that is that the, at the same time, if you want to develop a blockchain-enabled solution to offer, it would not typically make sense to start from scratch coding it yourself when there are companies out there that have developed a number of tools and capabilities, that it would be much more worth your time to license those tools from the appropriate other organizations. Kate, and then...
That was going to be my question, actually. I think most of us are probably interested in how you commercialize it in a corporate setting. Can you talk a little bit about two things? One is the Hyperledger Foundation and kind of the role they're playing around kind of like what Linux Foundation did in the early days of Linux, and also the concept of private versus public blockchain, because I think we're all probably thinking public blockchain may not be the right path for our companies. We're probably going to need to implement private.
Well, depending on, all right, let's talk, take those in reverse.
Yeah, I know. It was a big question.
The public versus private blockchain. Public blockchains are blockchains like the Bitcoin blockchain, and there are numerous other ones.
Right.
Where basically anyone who says, hey, I want to be part of this blockchain, I want to help keep the records updated and so forth, can do that. Now, there is a body of thinking out there that says because of the size and sustainability of public blockchains, they're ultimately more reliable in that kind of for applications that are appropriate for them. Private blockchains are closely related to the concept of permissioned blockchains. There are some subtle distinctions that we don't need to get into right today. But basically, it says there's a limited group of entities that are allowed to participate directly in the blockchain. And for that group of entities, the blockchain lets us have a decentralized record that we can all share and access. There's no one entity doing it for us. There's no third party we're having to pay for that service. But only those of us who have agreed to participate in that permission private blockchain are able to participate in. That is a great way to overcome the concerns, for example, of some of the organizations in financial services, some of the organizations in healthcare. Now, I think what we're going to see over time emerging, we're already starting to see interoperability between blockchains, ways, in fact, to plug different blockchains together. You may recall, or those of us who have been around that long will recall, that in the late 90s, there was the notion of intranets, where business people were saying, well, if we're just going to get together with our specific already identified suppliers and already identified customers or distributors, business partners, we'll set up a private internet and we'll take advantage of this internet technology, but it'll only be accessible by this specified group of people because, oh my gosh, we can't expose ourselves to the internet with all of those horrible people and pornography and everything else out there. And over time, much of that has gone away as the security controls and so forth on the broader internet world wide web have become more powerful. So I think we'll see some analogous things going on as an evolutionary process. Now, Hyperledger is a group of, it started off primarily in the banking area, and IBM has taken a key role in helping to facilitate that, but it's got a number of technology companies and other companies, and they're also moving into several other industry verticals, including healthcare. And along with the R3 consortium in the banking area, and much of the work done related to the Ethereum, which uses blockchain technology but makes a more sophisticated, complex use of blockchain technology and enabling of smart contracts to build on the underlying blockchain concept. I do believe that much as with the emergence all the way back to the 80s and the days of electronic data interchange and later in the 90s as e-commerce started to emerge, much of the progress that will happen with blockchain is going to be done by consortia that are focused in specific industry or application areas, quite simply because the underlying value of the blockchain is about sharing information between two or more entities. So if you're only doing it for your own private organization, unless you're geographically decentralized in such a way that it would be highly desirable to do it, you can just have a traditional centralized database and get most of the benefits of blockchain. It's about organizations, people, entities working together, and that's why I think the emergence of these consortia and the participation in these kinds of consortia on the part of organizations who are interested in taking advantage of this technology is an important step. All right.
Go ahead, this gentleman right back here.
I just wanted to bridge right off that question. Maybe I'd like your opinion on, if you look at the development of the internet, the IETF, you know, really was the standards body that made that work. And I think the interface in all of this is in the APIs, right? So it's, do you have a great app, but it only works on an iPhone? How does, because we're already starting to see chinks in the armor of these consortiums, right? These open source consortiums. How do we, or how do you see blockchain developing in an IETF type world where the APIs stay open source and many, many people can use them so they're not backed into certain technologies? And I'm not talking about private implementations. I'm talking about the real promise, that orthodontist example you gave at the beginning only works if there are universal APIs like email, right?
Right.
Email can be exchanged anywhere. How do we keep blockchain in the gold rush of this, capturing this technology and trying to patent it? How do we keep that, or how do you see that developing where that doesn't happen?
Your point, you bring up some very interesting points. We're at roughly the same point in the evolution of blockchain technology as the internet and the World Wide Web were in the mid-90s. We can debate 95, 97, but the point I'm trying to make is those issues, kinds of issues, were also unresolved. I did a similar presentation 20 years ago where I spoke to a group of people about this emerging technology called the World Wide Web and a business practice called e-commerce. And I described a scenario of the future. And afterwards, a fellow who was very technically knowledgeable about the then deployed capabilities of the internet and hands-on existing tools like client-server computing came up and said, Jack, I like your enthusiasm and optimism about the future, he said, but clearly you don't understand much about technology because we don't have the processing, we probably won't ever have the bandwidth, and we'll surely never have the security. So this notion you're trying to peddle that someday we're going to be sitting at our desks with computers and doing our banking electronically online will never happen. It just can't be done. And he was quite confident of his position. My experience is, and I think the same thing will happen with blockchain, and this is not to answer, but to address each of the points you raised, very appropriate points, but I don't want to go down the technological rabbit hole of trying to address each of them independently, is that when the economic drivers are there to take advantage of the value, the engineers we have are smart enough that unless solving a particular problem violates the fundamental laws of physics as we understand it, they will figure out a way to make this happen. Most of the debates about how to address exactly the kinds of important issues you brought up that are going on today have nothing whatsoever to do with can it be addressed. It's much more about what is the best way to address these issues, how do we address them, and sometimes there's a little bit of whose ox might be gored with one approach versus another approach. And for those people that are working on those kinds of standards and implementation activities, that's important work and it needs to continue to progress. And those people who are actively involved, especially in leading edge implementations today, are going to have to keep track of how does that progress over the next few quarters, over the next year or two. But that doesn't take away from the importance of businesses and organizations more broadly stepping back and saying, one way or another, these pieces are going to be coming into place over the next few years. And how they come into place, in most cases, is not going to radically change the capabilities that we will be able to derive from them as they do come into place. That's why I think it's so critical that people, organizations, think strategically about blockchain and related technologies, put a plan into place, and educate themselves as to how to do that.
Just a quick follow-up. Do you see like Hyperledger or some organization emerging that will keep standards, so like you can send email to anybody in this room, that was figured out in the 70s, right? Because that was figured out in the 70s and everybody abides by it. Do you see a standards body or some type of organization emerging that will facilitate that with blockchain?
Doug, do you have a comment on that?
Yeah, I've got at least a partial answer to that question. If you look at blockchain as sort of the evolution of the internet itself, if the World Wide Web was a mechanism where information could be transferred interpersonally, inter-enterprise-wise, blockchain is nothing more nor less than the way that value can be transmitted in a similar way. So you use that as your underlying infrastructure, TCP/IP or the internet. Those who are familiar with how those applications are actually built, it requires an API to the underlying data that's kept relative to the target application. So in other words, the evolution of the APIs that will animate these blockchain applications are evolving in vertically integrated ways, or vertically targeted ways. So the specific case of healthcare, the HL7 standards body, which completely dominates how the standards of electronic health records work, have got this joke. And they are hard at work developing what's called the FHIR standard, which is Fast Health Interoperability Resources. It'll be arriving on the scene late this year, early next year, which will set the tone and control for the APIs. So just as whether the banking industry, through whichever set of standards bodies they use, transportation, finance, and so forth, all will have their own standard organizations developing these APIs. In the case of healthcare, it's FHIR coming out of HL7. And in many ways, blockchain and FHIR were made for each other in a way that the only inhibitor to the FHIR APIs being used is the absence of the trust layer that permits people to come in and actually deploy those APIs. So keep an eye peeled on that one. And if you want to, again, if you're specifically interested in healthcare, you should be, blockchain-wise anyway, you should be focused on FHIR as the custodian of the APIs that you'll actually drag into these blockchain events.
Doug, thank you very much. Yes, sir.
Jack, thank you very much. I've got a question kind of on the other end of the scale. And unfortunately, my only real world feeling or experience with blockchain or with Bitcoin is a rather nefarious one. A lot of us have experienced in the last couple of years the increase in ransomware. And it seems like the go-to payment method for ransomware payments is now Bitcoin. Can you talk about that from a public or private, or what makes Bitcoin the go-to you can't?
The reason Bitcoin is used by, did everybody hear the question?
Yep.
The reason Bitcoin is used by hackers who are leveraging ransomware for their own benefit is that if you choose with Bitcoin, it can be what's called pseudonymous. In other words, there is a unique, one of those 20-character hash output strings that I talked about associated with each owner of Bitcoin. But if you choose to, you can make it very, very, very difficult to associate that string of characters with a specific individual or organization or entity. So it gives you protection against that. And probably the only form of payment that is even more anonymous than Bitcoin is one we've had for hundreds of years called cash. And now the advantage of Bitcoin, of course, is that can be transmitted electronically over great distances. If you're going to get paid off in cash, someone has to meet someone or make a drop or whatever. So there's other ways why that's not used as popularly. One of the challenges, one of the things we need to understand is new technologies are inherently neutral when it comes to being good versus bad. I'm sure that when Oog talked to Og back in the days of the cavemen, and Og said, look, I've got fire, and Oog said, oh, somebody's going to get burned. And every new technology since then has had its positive, and bad people can be very creative in leveraging new technologies. What does that mean? It doesn't mean people shouldn't be using Bitcoin or even broadly blockchain. It means people need to put better security on their systems so the hackers can't get in and tie them up with ransomware. And also encourage their people not to do things like pasting their passwords on the front of their computers.
So if we would want to use the blockchain for transactions like ownership of stocks, right now, when we look at stock transactions at the NYSE, they're in nanoseconds. And we're talking about the blockchain.
The transactions are in nanoseconds. The settlements take days.
Mm-hmm. Oh, okay. That makes sense. So
with blockchain, it'll be done within minutes.
Within minutes.
That's an application, very interesting application, as part of the broader set of applications in financial services. So it's got huge potential for us. Yes?
Hey, Jack. So when I'm looking at this from near-term future, right, help me understand maybe what it's not good for. I mean, it's very transactional. It seems good for ledger kind of stuff. But what about unstructured data, large image files, latency? What should I maybe be slicing off my list?
All right. Blockchain is not intended for huge files. One of the current short-term challenges, just as in 1997, we didn't have the bandwidth to do all this stuff. Well, the bandwidth became provided because we're there. Blockchain is now not as fast and as efficient as it could be. There are very varying sets of approaches to addressing that particular issue. But one of the things that is fairly straightforward is to keep those things that do not have to be continually updated and changed linked to the blockchain, but off blockchain. So for example, so let's say you've got a 2 gigabyte file that is, say, the design file for 3D printing of a set of braces, okay? Well, you don't want to tie up the blockchain with 2 gigabyte files. So instead, you store that off. You might use something like the Interplanetary File System, IPFS, which is a decentralized file system, or storage, STORJ, which is based right here in Atlanta. These are decentralized file systems that break the files up into unrecognizable little pieces, store them all over the internet, and they can be invoked and pulled together when you want, and you have a hash of that file that's stored on the blockchain. When you exchange the rights to do that, you represent, you pull that file together, you run it through the same hashing algorithm, it matches up what's stored on the blockchain, you know you've got the right original file that you're entitled to download, and now you can download it. We don't slow down the blockchain because we only have a few dozen characters of information stored on the blockchain rather than multiple megabits or gigabits or what have you. So though that's sort of off-chain applications. The other thing is, as with any new emerging technology, the objective is not to figure out how to use blockchain. The objective is figure out how to improve the way you manage your business, you organize your processes, you enhance your systems like your healthcare system, and then is blockchain going to be an enabler to do it? A lot of the ideas people come up with, oh, let's use blockchain for thus and so, in many cases, a properly secured centralized database will be just as effective and far more efficient than trying to implement on blockchain. So don't get the cart before the horse. Blockchain's going to give us tremendous power and capabilities, but allow the underlying needs of the process or system or organization to drive the adoption of the technology and not the other way around. Well, I think that's probably a good one to end on. I will be here for as long as you all would like to mingle and talk, so it would be a pleasure. I enjoyed it. Thank you so very much for your time.
Topic obviously was a huge topic at HIMSS in Orlando this year. Obviously, we know why. So we thank you so much for sharing your knowledge here at this area. I want to remind everybody about next week on Wednesday, the career fair again, and April 20th. Please mark your calendars. First 100 days of Trump's administration will tell you all about it. So thank you again. Thank you for coming and have a great day.